We're getting close to the end of the floor.
It has 16 gold pieces on the floor.
That's all right, by Leo. We can sit on the other side.
Sit there.
Okay.
The collectors.
They should have been.
We thought we were trying to get.
Then if you go down to Marquette, you have a place called Peak.
I will be. You might send another reporter up. I'm not 100% sure. I think my boss actually got all of your brothers tonight. That's what I was told.
Jill, do you have the live stream address with you?
I can find it.
National Monument. I'm Jim Nepstead. I'm the superintendent of this wonderful park, which is being honored tomorrow, with the addition of another quarter in the United States Mint's America the Beautiful series of quarters. We're thrilled to be the subject of this particular coin. I hope you all find the design as intriguing as I do. It was a very difficult design, I think, by all admissions, given the nature of the mounds themselves. But I think the artist and sculptor, in my opinion anyway, did a wonderful job portraying three mounds, which are actually configured in their very, very close to the actual configuration on the ground. These are three mounds that is known as the Marching Bear group of mounds in the south unit of the park, and it was one of the actually it's probably the only grouping of both bear and bird mounds in close proximity to each other that we could use in this particular way. So it seems that they were destined to be on a quarter someday. This is an event that is hosted by the United States Mint. The United States National Park Service is merely providing the space for it tonight, so I am going to quickly exit the stage here. And before anybody starts asking me questions about coins or anything that I can't answer. But I am kind of curious, who thinks they traveled the furthest to get here? Number of hands. Where are you from?
Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania?
I was going to say, I traveled from Pennsylvania and from
Yeah, you're from the other side.
It's a long trip.
Okay.
Where's Sid?
Well, Sid, we at California. Yeah. He's not here yet.
Yeah,
he's here somewhere, but he's not.
I'm curious, how many of you have attended other events like this for the America the Beautiful series of quarters?
Really?
A number of you.
I don't think
you mean anything. I have, though. It doesn't matter.
You've been one or two, huh?
I've been a couple. Yeah.
Well, tonight I'd like to introduce a couple of special guests here at Effigy Mounds National Monument. We have Debbie Dawson with the United States Mint.
Mark Landry.
Mark Landry, from the Philadelphia Mint as well, and they will take it from here. I appreciate you all coming here tonight. I hope that you'll have the time to attend the official launch event tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock in Waukon at the local high school. It'll be a fun event, I think, and again, I hope to see a lot of these same faces there tomorrow morning as well. So without further ado.
Jim, thank you. Well, again, welcome everybody. I got to say, I'm excited to be here. It was a long trip to get here. Spent about 11 hours yesterday traveling to get here. But I really enjoy doing these events, and this is a great quarter. To put this in perspective, in January and December, we made about 180, just in Philadelphia, we made about 185 million of these quarters. They're always fun to strike. We look forward to the new design when they come out. You know, the employees take great pride in striking these quarters that represent these great national parks and national monuments in the United States. I'm going to talk a little bit, probably mostly about Philadelphia, because obviously that's what I know most. We're excited this year. This year is our 225th anniversary of the United States Mint, and we've been making coins in Philadelphia for those full 225 years. So it's a historic year for us. We've got some great new products coming out. We'll talk about those a little bit. But our bread and butter is really circulating coins. We make a lot of circulating coins. Last year in Philadelphia alone, we count fiscal year, so October of 15 through September 16, we made 8.5 billion circulating coins in Philadelphia. That's about 40 million coins per working day. And like I said, we love it. We look forward to the new designs, not only on the quarters, but on the dollars too, the rotating designs on the dollars, and we're sorry to see the president program end. But the circulating coin production is strong. And to put it in perspective, in 2012, between us and in Denver, and we typically split the order, we made 9.6 billion total coins. In 2013, we made 10.5 billion total coins. In 14, we made 12.6 billion total coins. In 15, we made 16 billion, and in last year in 16, we made 16.5 billion. It looks like so far our forecast for this fiscal year for 17 is going to be about 14.5 billion. But with the consumer confidence trending up the last couple of months, I wouldn't be surprised to see that approach the 15 and 16 billion range also. Talk about NUMMI a little bit. Again, with our 225th anniversary, we've got a couple of new products coming out. April 2nd this year, we've got a new gold, 1 ounce gold coin that will represent modern liberty for our 225th anniversary. It's a beautiful coin. It's struck at our West Point facility. We're also going to bring out silver medals, same designs as the gold coin. Silver medals, we're going to bring them out first in a proof version in Philadelphia. And then we're going to do a four coin set, very late in the year, that will have four different versions, one from each mint. We'll do a reverse proof in Philadelphia. I think San Francisco is going to do a proof. I think West Point is going to do an enhanced uncirculated, and Denver is going to do an uncirculated coin. So we're metal. Those will all be in 1 ounce silver on 999 buy-in. So we're excited about that. Bullion, we continue we're producing about 1 million ounces of silver bullion each week. We spent most of the year last year on allocation, which means we limited the sales to that amount until probably late summer, early fall, and then we were able to go off allocation. But our bullion program remains strong. We started out January with very strong sales in the 5-6 million range. So that looks good, looks real good. Talk a little bit about Philadelphia. We continue to try to improve quality. That we are aggressively reviewing our processes. We've made continuous process improvements over the last few years, but we continue to look to make additional improvements. And we do that for two reasons. One, to lower the cost of the coins, which we've done significantly. And two, to improve the quality and the consistency. Some of the things we're looking at
our, we're looking at that, probably the largest source of variation is through our annealing process, where we, where after we cut the blanks from strip, we run them through a large furnace in 3,000-pound batches, and it basically softens the blanks, and it allows us to strike a better image, put a better image on the coin with less tonnage. So we're doing some things, one, to improve that process, to improve the atmosphere in that furnace, to reduce oxides, which are basically rust. It's not rust in our process, but it's very similar to that. So we can get a very bright, brilliant coin. We're actually doing a study. Well, I'll do the study in Philadelphia this spring, probably May, June, where we're purchasing a prototype blanking die that might eliminate the need for us to anneal those blanks, which would just be phenomenal, because again, that's the largest source of variation in our process. We're also looking at doing a lot of things with dies. We've been running the actual design of our dies have been the same for years. We're starting to look at, can we improve that process? We put a flat on the side of a die so it lines up perfect every time, but there is a little there's a little possibility that they can rotate. So we're looking at changing the designs of the dies to eliminate that possibility. But we continue to look at new things, look at new technologies, again, to improve the quality of the coins, to improve the consistency of the coins, and to drive the price, drive our costs down. It's the right thing to do for the general public, for the taxpayers, but it also feeds over into our numismatic product, so we can try to keep the cost of our numismatic coins at their lowest level also. So we're pretty excited. Again, the 225th anniversary, we're going to have some events, internal events this year to celebrate. We've got some nice new product, and when you guys see the product, and unfortunately, since it's not released, I can't bring it here and show you today, but there's going to be some great product in silver medals and a gold coin. And that's about all I really wanted to say. I really just give you a little brief update on where we are, what were some of the projects we're working on. I really like to open it to questions and get your guys' input.
You mentioned that you're excited about your 225th anniversary.
Yes.
And you, of course, have made some celebration on your penny production in Philadelphia for that event, and you mentioned internal events. Did you ever think about having an external event for that celebration?
We have thought about it, and at this time we don't have external events planned. We will likely go out with some PR things and some media things to help us recognize the significance of the event. But at this time, we don't have anything planned for outside. There's a question in the back.
When you are making your quarter, I like a book here. The last year, on 2021, I think it is, there's only one quarter coming out. Are you thinking about making four more quarters to fill up your thing? What I was suggesting is having primarily the same thing, America the Beautiful, but having a contest for the places you would want to put on it, say like, and then have it online voting, I think you'd pick up a lot of new collectors.
It's a good point. I will say we won't do that because we really only do what we're legislated to do. We can't just come up with ideas. We can't create our own ideas for coins. We have a little bit of authorization that we can do that with medals, and again, that's why we're going to celebrate our 225th anniversary with primarily medal products, because we have more authorization, more leeway to do that. We have a little bit of leeway in the 24 karat gold, and again, that's why we can come out with a 225th anniversary product in the gold. But we have zero leeway with circulating coins. We basically do what Congress legislates us to do. And they're, in a lot of cases, extremely specific. They'll tell us what has to be on the obverse, they'll tell us what has to be on the reverse, they'll tell us the metal composition of the coin. And then we just enact on the law that they pass. Now, I will say, we do have the ability to do a second round of National Parks quarters, but it would be a whole second round. It wouldn't be just to fill in holes at the end of that year. If we chose to do that, then it would be basically going to all the states and all the territories and saying we're going to do a second park, National Parks iteration, and then go through the process of picking sites and monuments and parks, and would lay out a schedule, you know, long range schedule like we have done for this one.
Like in baseball for the All-Star game, they have online voting.
Right.
And it's fantastic, the number of people new voting.
I will say, we have a couple of programs coming up in 18. Although the designs are being done right now, and I don't think they've hit. Breast cancer coin has. But we do have a couple of the breast cancer commemorative coin for 2018, and the World War I coin had put out calls to artists to submit designs. Now, I don't know exactly the voting. I think the voting is not nationwide. It is
open. Yeah, okay. And I think the breast cancer just closed.
The voting was done by committee. The contest was open.
The contest was open nationwide to anyone who wanted to submit designs, but the actual selection of the coin was done. And I know they're talking. We've had some success. We did that with the commemorative baseball Hall of Fame coin a couple of years ago also, where we had an open design competition. Congress obviously likes that. I think it was very successful. So they're adding that, and it's primarily to language for commemorative coins. I think they're talking about doing one for the
Apollo in 2019.
Yes.
Uh-huh. But that legislation hasn't been authorized yet.
Right. That will be that, and I've seen pieces of the legislation, and that'll be a phenomenal commemorative coin. They're talking about it. I mean, again, we're talking this. There isn't legislation yet set in stone, but we're talking about another curved coin. We're talking about doing a curved. The legislation, as it's written, is talking about doing a curved 5-ounce silver coin, which would be quite a challenge for us. But it's a challenge that we would look forward to addressing.
Did I say something? Sure. That legislation did pass, and it was signed by the president.
Oh, it was?
Okay. In December.
Okay, thank you. Other questions? Yes.
I have a question on those 5-ounce renditions. So when that first came out, it was silver was probably on the north side of $20 an ounce. We've been down $15, $16, $70 an ounce, and you've got $85 worth of silver in there. It's $149.95 to buy that. Mm-hmm. Is there any possibility you'd get a little more reasonable on your pricing structure as the bullion fluctuates?
I would tell you, I think that is reasonable. I don't know if you look at other World Mint commemorative coins. Some of them, I mean, they're getting $100+ for a 1-ounce coin. So we think that's reasonable. We do offer the same version in a bullion coin. It doesn't have the frosted finish. And those prices, at least we sell them to our authorized purchasers, are significantly less. It's a coin basically in no packaging.
Yeah, the Iowa quarter is about $107 if you buy it from one of the distributors. So, yeah.
I know we sell it to them at spot price of silver plus, I think it's a few bucks. So. Mm-hmm. Yes.
I, for one, am very happy that you have these forums and that you and others come as the representative of the Mint. I'm wondering if you would ever consider having a co-representative from the Mint in terms of your citizens advisory personnel. And I, for one, would be very excited to have your latest citizen advisory committee member join one of these events. And of course, I'm speaking of Kareem Abdul-Jabbar.
I don't know that we've ever considered that. We'll certainly pass that on.
And I do know that our meetings we do have are open to the public, so you could come to them.
Well, you know, like, if you want to perhaps increase your people that buy things, if you were to have Kareem Abdul-Jabbar join one of you, that would perhaps open the doors to sports fans, to the whole numismatic.
I would love that.
Me too.
We're happy, we just announced he's just become a member of the Citizens Coin Advisory Committee. I haven't talked to him personally, I haven't met him personally, but I understand he's very excited about it and very into Americana. And I would expect him to be an outstanding member of the Citizens Coin Advisory Committee, and certainly, I think that's a good suggestion. Can we do it? I don't know. We don't pay them. They do travel at their own cost. They do a lot of things at on their own dime, but we can certainly take that suggestion back. Other questions? Yes.
Are there certain legislators that have more push or pull? We can all write our congressmen, but sometimes you wonder if they do anything at all. But are there certain legislators that have more pull with you guys or in the legislature that can get things done or get suggestions too that might be more interested in doing something?
That's a difficult question to answer because we don't have any pull with them. Occasionally, when they do write legislation, they will ask us occasionally. Sometimes they just write legislation and we've got to go out and produce a coin based on their designs, their specifications, and their timeline. Occasionally, if there's something complicated, they will come to us and ask us our opinion. I don't know, there have been some congressmen and senators that have been involved, and I would go back and look at the sponsors of the co-sponsors of the commemorative coins, look at sponsors of other coin legislation, and that would be my recommendation, probably the best way to go.
Kind of related, does any of your legislation come from some specific committees, like the Commerce Committee?
I don't know enough about it to give you a good answer, to tell you the truth. I suspect it probably does, but I just don't know enough about
it. I'm guessing it does, and I don't have a clue which one it would be either.
Okay, could I answer a couple of those questions?
Absolutely.
I'm Mike Olson. I'm a former member of the CCAC, and I worked with Congressman Blum on the Apollo coin legislation. If anybody's from this district, you'll know that Congressman Blum will be one of the original five co-sponsors of that bill. And that was simply an idea from myself to Congressman Blum. He carried it on to the other appropriate representatives in the House that represent the Cape Kennedy area and then over in Texas. That's how that bill got done. So anybody with an idea like that is certainly authorized and welcome to give it to your senator or your representative. That's how those things get done. And as far as the in the Congress, the House Financial Services Committee is the committee it has to get out of before everybody else votes on it. I believe it's the Senate Banking Committee on the Senate side. And coins have a little bit of a different threshold they need to meet to become law. I learned a lot working with Congressman Blum and the rest of them on this when we did this. It's a two-thirds majority. It's got to get passed. Any coin bill's got to get two-thirds of support from the House and the Senate, and then be signed by the President. It's not just a simple majority.
Thank you. Other questions?
You mentioned that the presidential coin is going by the wayside. Now, why is that? I mean, is it because of
the legislation?
The legislation. Yeah. Okay, so there won't be any like Obama coin or anything like that.
At this time, we've been
purchasing all the coins, and that's why.
Yeah, and at this time, no. And I'm not an expert on legislation. I'm really a manufacturing expert.
Right.
That's my expertise. I mean, we didn't produce a Jimmy Carter coin also because the legislation specified that we don't produce coins of living individuals.
Exactly.
So it was very specific. And to my knowledge, the program has ended. Now, would Congress pick up, you know, a few years from now and want to continue and have a presidential dollar coin for each president?
You really want that Obama coin, huh?
Yeah, I do. And so the last coin is going to be Reagan, then? Okay. Yes. Yes to that answer.
Other questions?
Do you anticipate any changes to the U.S. Mint and or its programs with our current government?
I don't know. The government's just been in place for a few weeks right now. But I don't at this time. I think we're one of the few agencies that actually produce product. And if I do say so, I think we do quite a good job of it. I will tell you, I get dignitaries from mints all across the world into Philadelphia, and they're like kids in a candy shop. They can't believe, they can't believe the quality of the coins we produce, the sheer volume of the coins we produce, and then I show them an annual report and show them the cost we produce, and they're amazed. So I don't know. It's too early to tell. Certainly, some of the executive orders, we're under the federal hiring ban, so they do affect us. But I think it's just too early to tell. I mean, I haven't heard talk of anything beyond the current executive orders that do affect us as a federal government agency. Yes?
Someone alluded earlier to the 2017 cent that has a mint mark on it.
Yes.
Which is a commemorative. Are all the cents produced this year at Philadelphia coming with a mint mark?
Yes.
And do you have any other plans to commemorate the 225th anniversary this year, like a quarter, nickel, half dollar?
The silver medals, again, the first one will be produced in Philadelphia. It'll be a proof version.
And that's similar design to the African-American gold $100 coin?
Yes.
And will they be a different diameter so that unscrupulous people can't gold plate a silver one and call it a
Yes, the silver gold? The silver metal will be a lot larger. It also will not, it's a metal, it will not have a denomination.
So it'll be slightly different wording on obverse or edge or something?
At this point, I don't believe we'll have them, they will not be edge lettered at this point. And they won't have a denomination on them, but they're a completely different size than the gold 1 ounce. And again, later in the calendar year, probably next fall, at the earliest, we will have a four coin metal set with one distinct coin from each mint. Other questions?
Do you anticipate the Frederick Douglass event and the Statue of Liberty event to be at the particular sites as opposed to a farther site away where there'd be more room?
Debbie, I don't know if you can answer that.
The Frederick Douglass will be at the event site. Ellis Island will not be on the island. The coin forum likely will be on the island, but they'll have it at a close by facility.
Should I make my reservations for the boat to get to Ellis Island now?
I'm sure we'll figure out something, the logistic planning.
Then you have to make reservations far in advance to get to Ellis Island.
Yeah, I'm sure that they will accommodate if that's the route we go.
Thank you.
Yes, you're welcome.
On a related question, the Missouri launch in June.
Yes.
Where is the location for that?
It's going to be Alley Springs, where the
grist mill is.
Yes,
on the coin.
Correct. Okay. Yeah. Yep.
I'm from Iowa. I'm not going to make Ellis Island, but I might make
Okay. All right. Well, we're looking at a possible June 5th date for that. So.
You don't know the school, the release, or will it be a high school down there?
It'll be at the facility. On the ground.
Everything is kind of like the Lincoln cents that you did in Indiana and Illinois.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the question.
Well, in other words, the release and the ceremony will be in the same physical location, not like going to Waukon to a high school.
Correct.
Thank you.
Yes.
Other questions?
Hey, what do you think of the weather here?
You know what? In February, I think it's beautiful right now.
they turned up the heat for you guys. Yeah.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Wait till tomorrow.
Wait till tomorrow.
Where are you from, Mark?
I'm from Michigan originally, so I'm a little bit used to the cold. But yes, I work in Philadelphia, and it's fairly mild in Philadelphia. The winters are fairly mild, so. Other questions?
What is your background, sir?
My background? Mm-hmm. It's prior to coming to the Mint, I've been at the Mint, I'll be 9 years next month. Primarily automotive. Automotive, heavy truck, defense. I spent 25 years in manufacturing. In primarily automotive. 5 years in defense industry, building M1A1 Abrams tanks, and a couple of years in the heavy truck industry, and then the rest out of the automotive industry.
Are you making tanks at the Mint, too?
Making coins out of tanks.
and I love manufacturing. I grew up in, and I grew up in the Detroit area. My dad worked for General Motors. My grandfather worked for General Motors. So we have a long history in our family of working in manufacturing in for a long time, primarily the automotive industry. Yes.
How many employees at the facility?
We have roughly 450. That includes all the employees that make the coins. That includes the artists and engravers. We have a small R&D function that includes police force because we protect the facility, the assets, and the people in the building. So roughly 450. It fluctuates. One thing we've done in probably the last 4 years is we get the orders from the Federal Reserve are all over the place. I mean, the order from the Federal Reserve in February, and I don't even pay attention to it much anymore, would probably be a couple hundred to 400 million coins. But in 2 to 3 months, that order will be 1.6 to 2 billion coins. So one of the things we've done over the last 4 years is we've tried to level our production, okay? Because the Fed demand, the Fed order to us, is cyclical and starts probably November, December, January, and February, where it drops to very low levels. Then in the spring, it increases, and summer into probably July, it's at very high levels, a couple billion a month. So what we try to do is to produce at a fairly level rate throughout the year. That way, I don't have to swing the number of employees I need. I don't need temporary employees. I don't need to bring a whole bunch of people on and teach them for a couple of months and then let them go later. It's driven a lot of our improvements also. It's helped drive a lot of our improvements, a lot of consistency. We have a base workforce in those levels and produce almost the same every month. Now, there is variation. And this month they shut down for a week to do maintenance, and primarily significant preventative maintenance, because some of our equipment is quite large. And if I take a piece of equipment down, a furnace, it takes a day and a half just to cool down before I can get anybody in to touch it, to work on it. And then once we've actually done the work on it, it takes another day and a half to heat back up to temperature before I can run any blanks through it. So we've shut down for a month in the end of January, shut down for a week at the end of January, 1st of February, and this is a good time for us to do that. But we try to level our production I said we produced about 40 million coins last year. We try to keep our production level between 35 and 40 million coins each day, each production day of the year. Yes?
What's the average lifespan of a coin or paper?
The last data I saw, and I'm not an expert, other people have studied this, it's between 25 and 30 years for a coin. Now, obviously, you can pull pocket change out and see coins older than that, and see coins a lot newer than that. the number on the notes has changed significantly. I don't know what it is right now. I know they used to say it was about a year and a half for a dollar note, and then all of a sudden that it increased to 2+ to 2, 3 to 5 years. I can't really speak to that. I'm very confident that the coins will last 25 to 30 years easily. Other questions?
Do we want the Richard Masters?
Yeah, we have Richard Masters in the audience.
Is Richard here? Richard Masters?
But he's coming tomorrow.
Okay.
Oh, is he? Okay. All right. Just so you know, Richard Masters actually is a native Iowan, a fourth generation, and he was the designer.
He was the artist.
The artist. Oh.
Yes.
So.
Yeah, he designed the line, the actual art, and then we have a full time sculptor, engraver that sculpted it, so we're able to produce it.
Could you maybe share some information on if some of these folks would want to visit Philadelphia for a tour or Denver, how they go about doing that?
Absolutely. We are open during the winter months. We're open 5 days for open to the public for a tour. Now, it is a self-guided tour. You don't need reservations. You can just walk up to the door. Basically, you need to show ID and go through, similar to airport. I think it's a little easier to get into than getting into an airport. We do have police officers there. You know, don't bring weapons. Don't bring those type of things.
They take Pennsylvania driver's licenses there.
They do.
Okay.
They do take Pennsylvania driver's license. They're going to ask you for an ID. It's self-guided tour. We on our mezzanine, we have just some phenomenal artifacts from the. We're in our fourth building, the fourth mint in Philadelphia since 1792. We've got artifacts from the first mint. We've got artifacts from each of the buildings. We've got a series of Tiffany mosaics in our front lobby that are phenomenal. They were produced for us in the 1900, early 1900 to 1915 maybe. That are just phenomenal and priceless. One of my favorite artifacts is we actually have a letter signed by George Washington. Presenting a gold medal to General Anthony Wayne, which is just phenomenal. But you go through and you can review some of the artifacts. We've got a couple of activities for the kids, so the kids will be interested. We've got a little kind of shadow box show that goes through some of the potential discussions a couple hundred years ago between Hamilton and Thomas Jefferson talking about minting coins and should we do it, should we continue to. Before that time, we were using foreign coins. Citizens were using foreign coins in the United States. So I think it's pretty neat. When you go through that area, then you can go up and you're basically three floors up and you can look down onto the production floor through the different areas of the mint. So I think it's a pretty neat tour. I do actually go walk it occasionally I want to see what it looks like, what our visitors are seeing, and make sure it looks good and looks appropriate. And I will tell you, I try to talk to the visitors that are taking the tour, and you know, the kids get excited about it. So I think it's great. Denver has a tour much limited, more limited on numbers. You actually have to sign up and get reservations. You sign up through our website. They have guided tours at this time, where a tour guide will take a small group through and explain the different aspects of coin production. But I highly recommend also, if you're in Denver, to look that up. You just you've got to go online and sign up for it beforehand, and you'll get a time. When you do sign up, you'll get a time and a specific time to go in and do it.
Except right now the reservation system is down.
Oh, okay. I didn't realize that.
Except because we had some issues with it. So right now they're operating like the White House. You walk up and get a ticket.
Okay.
They have so many tickets for the day.
Okay.
That's how it's working temporarily.
And we're also looking at changing that to allow more visitors through, but that's a longer term project. And the reason we don't have that in Denver is because you actually walk through some areas of the plant. The tour will not through the working plant, but through the office area, and we just can't have people wandering around, so. But I highly recommend both of them, and if you get to either of those cities, I think you would enjoy that.
Was there a shortage on the last quarter for the American the Beautiful? I still haven't found one.
The volumes are down a little bit. Right now, the volume, from the last couple of years, we're down a little less than 10% this time, this year, versus what we produced last year. So, a little bit. But like I said, I know I just produced 185 million Effigy Mound quarters in Philadelphia alone.
Mm-hmm.
So, you will see them. We produce them, we ship them to the Fed. They don't necessarily go out first from the Federal Reserve. There's 200 and some plus locations, Federal Reserve locations, that we ship to, where they're distributing coins to banks. And it's not always a first in, first out for them. So I'd just keep looking through your change.
Keep looking.
And you'll come across them, because we're producing significant quantities.
Okay.
Yes.
You mentioned December or January production on the Effigy Mounds coin. What are you producing now? Are you into the third one or the second one of the season, or do you know for sure?
We just started producing in, which one is it? I forget.
The next one, Frederick Douglass.
Douglass.
Yeah, I believe we just started producing that.
And miniature figures are similar for Denver, or a little more?
We try to split the order.
Okay.
So they'll be roughly the same.
Tomorrow's coins are Denver Mint?
Denver Mint.
Yeah.
And so, you know, Denver primarily supplies west of the Mississippi. Now, we're right on the Mississippi.
Well, maybe you brought some out for us, so many coins.
And we supply primarily the east of the Mississippi out of Philadelphia coins. And that's, you know, for cost. I mean, the cost to ship coins, it actually, the demand east of the Mississippi is about equal to the demand west of the Mississippi. So it works well. Now we will occasionally, if Denver has a problem with a quarter line, I'll produce more. But that's fairly uncommon. Yes.
Did we discuss this already? I mean, does the Mint in Washington, D.C., does it produce coins or just
mints? It's our headquarters facility, and they do not produce any coins.
Okay.
Yeah, right. They do have a sales kiosk, though. We do a lot of sales out of the facility.
Okay.
But they do not produce coins. Thank you for asking. We produce circulating coins in Philadelphia and Denver. We produce numismatic product in San Francisco. And then we primarily produce mostly gold and silver bullion and numismatic products out of West Point. Now, the one nice thing about Philadelphia is we do a little bit of everything. I produce numismatic products. I produce almost all the national metals. We have produced silver bullion. We do produce gold products on occasion, but it's more of an occasion. West Point is our specialty mint for those type products. Yes.
You know, you guys do the spouses' medals.
Yeah.
They had,
we make those out of West Point.
Go out of West Point.
No, I will say also I make all the dyes for West Point in Philadelphia. They don't have a dye manufacturing facility, so I make the dyes for everything they make.
I had a little trouble getting the last two years of the medals for the spouses' medals.
Right.
I mean, they ran out like really fast.
Yeah.
I didn't know what. They didn't produce that many, or?
The volumes have been, you know, fairly consistent on those. I don't know. I don't know what the volumes for the ones you're talking about. Now there are a couple of popular first spouses in that time period, and I would guess that's probably what happened, but I don't know for sure.
Here tonight, and to encourage you to once again attend the event tomorrow morning, 10 o'clock at the high school in Waukon, Iowa.
How long will that go?
It's roughly an hour. probably from
45 minutes.
About 35, 40 minutes right now, the way the agenda or the program is lined up. It's 3 minutes, Jim, not 13.
She's got a big hook.
I do. It's called 1,200 children won't let you speak.
Are there any tips about parking up there or anything, or just there'll be people directing
it's
you?
It's a high school that is in session, and so there's very large parking lots there, but. They're full to begin with. From what I understand, I think the school was going to encourage teachers and students to park as much as possible on the streets.
And when we were there today, they also have like a center next door and then a parking lot back behind. So they have several, big events there, and said most of the locals and know where to park. So for you,
I'll just drive around and circle.
That's right. There you go. Just keep circling.
The west side of the school, that's where the entrance closest to the gymnasium where the event will be held. There's large parking lots at both ends, but it's the west side of the school again that you'll want to aim as much as possible for. Whether there will be space available in the parking lot itself, I honestly don't know, and we won't know until tomorrow.
Yeah, and I had asked Dave about it, and he just recommended, there's other parking lots connected kind of around, so there is parking.
And there's residential streets and stuff like that. The largest part of the crowd, in all honesty, will be the student body itself. I mean, the entire school district is going to be there.
Yeah.
Every student in the McKee community school district will be there. Hundreds of kids. So the crowd will be larger than the apparent number of cars in the parking lot, fortunately for all of us. It's just about anything else, best parking goes to those who show up first. So you might want to show up a little on the early side.
Yeah. And the ceremony is about 35, 40 minutes. And then right after that will be the coin exchange. The Current Brothers Bank will be on site to do the one roll minimum, 10 roll maximum for cash to get your Effigy Mounds D quarters.
And what are we doing if the weather turns bad?
We will make that call in the morning and probably delay it by a couple hours.
Yeah, I mean, worst case scenario, watch local newscasts if the El McKee Community School District has a delayed opening or a closing, which is very unlikely at this stage by the sounds of the weather forecast. But if that were to happen, obviously the event time is going to slide.
Wait, this guy over here said he has control over the heat out here.
One more day.
Got it.
Yeah, just hold off for one more day. Yeah.
Okay. Well, and I'd also like to thank our guests for this evening too, Debbie and Mark. Sorry, spaced on your name right at the beginning of the program. I know I learned a lot. For one thing, that apparently you're getting tens of millions of product per month per employee.
Absolutely.
That's efficiency.
Absolutely. There is no mid country in the world that produces coins more efficiently than we do.
Yeah. That's great.
And I'd like to thank you, Jim, too, and your staff have been great to work with, and they've been our partners in this event. So I want to thank them. It's a joint venture for us, and it's very exciting. Of course, we're happy to have the bank on board as well. So.
Yeah,
it's a collaborative effort.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Exactly. It's a big deal for us. We're a small park with a small staff. We have a fraction of the staff that you're working with at Ozarks, for instance, for the Missouri event. We have to do the same amount of planning and so on. So it's been a big deal for us. But we're excited for the event. We're super excited to see the coin in circulation. I gotta say, I had a sneak peek at one of them this morning, and I was really, really pleased with how well the mounds stand out. I mean, that's outstanding. I just can't believe the detail that can be placed on a coin the size of a quarter these days. You know, kudos to you and your workers.
Thank you.
Yep. Are you going to have the quarters here for exchange?
Tomorrow.
We do have a annual set that just came out, the 2017, that actually shows the proof version of the quarter in here if you guys want to come up and look at it. So, there will be other products coming out later in the year.
But snatch those up fast because I haven't told them yet that this bear is upside down.
Funny.
That is, again, if you missed the very beginning, that's the actual configuration of three actual mounds here in the park.
Now, where are they? Are they easy to get to?
Well, not this time of year. Right. You know, it's about a 2-mile hike.
Is it 2 miles? Okay.
It's a group of mounds known as the Marching Bear Mound Group. It's, you know, arguably the most spectacular mound group in the park.
Okay.
And, again, it's the only place where you'll find both bear and bird mounds in close proximity to each other, which made them ideal so we could portray multiple types of effigy mounds all in the same space. Again, thanks everybody for being here.
Thank you.